So thanks for coming. I present myself. My name is Vianney Rancurel. I'm the director of research of Scality. So there is some kind of an echo. And I'm going to present a new library that we have been developing past year, which is applied to storage. So this is basically the outline. So introduction, why we do this, some quick properties of code, and why we started our own investigation on new types of codes, and one application, which is decentralized storage. And then, finally, how to use the library. So maybe you know Scality. We currently have two products. We have a Scality Ring, which is a petabyte scale software-defined storage solution. We aggregate commodity servers into a large pool of storage, and we support various file and object storage protocols. We have a new product that we just launched last week, which is called Zenko, which is a multi-cloud data controller, so which allows you to move your data from your ring, for instance, to the cloud. It's based upon Kubernetes and also support SUNFS. So why Quadiron? So Quadiron actually is not an actual product of Scality. This is more research. We are passionate about building large-scale storage systems, petabyte scale. So we are familiar with problematics, especially large file pools. So we were looking for an open source, high performance Azure code library. So we wanted to build a storage system which was cheap, with almost no synchronization, durable, of course, and we needed a very large number of parities. For instance, a number which is much larger than 100. So typically in storage, you find 10 plus 4, or typically 20 plus 10 maybe in some systems, and we wanted something like even larger. So we tried to find a library, and we didn't find. So I decided to make it, to make some research and to make it. And we decided to be totally open source because this is our contribution to the community. We didn't want the yet another patented library on Azure code. We wanted to research and to give back to the community. This is the main motivation. So we are also preparing a paper on this. If you're interested, I could share it with you. So you all know what is an Azure code, so I will go relatively fast. And you had one session just before about it. Just about the notation I use, so I use C and K to express a code which is N equal K plus M. So K is the number of data fragments, and M is the number of Azure codes. So this is the notation we find in the literature of research. So you have two main codes, type of codes. So for instance, C96, for instance, you have your data that you split in six, and we are going to generate three fragments, so it's nine fragments in total. So it's called C96. And there is another type of code which is called non-systematic, where you actually generate nine coding fragments, and somehow you obfuscate the data. So we'll see, sometimes it's interesting, sometimes it's not. So in any case, you need typically K data fragments to recover. So in this case, we lost two data fragments and one coding, but we still have six fragments, so we are able to decode. So in this case, it's exactly the same, but in any case, if we are retrieving K fragments, we need to decode. This is the main drawback of non-systematic code. So quickly, a summary of interest for us, so the optimality. So typically, the very important property, which is called the MDS, so maximum distance separability, it guarantees that with any K fragment, you can decode. And we'll see that there are some other type of codes which are not MDS, which have interesting properties, but not in MDS. Systematicity, so we just saw it. So least systematic or non-systematic, if you maintain K data fragment in plain text, or if you code all of them. Of course, codes are characterized by their speed, encoding speed, decoding speed, but also by the rate. So the rate is another property which is defined by k out of n. And according to the application, you will have a different rate. So typically, how many data fragments you have compared to how many coding fragments. And some codes are very good for some rates and very bad for some other rates. So, okay. Another interesting property is the adaptivity, so ability to change K and M without having to regenerate everything. The confidentiality, so one interesting thing about the systematic codes is they are confidential. They are different from threshold schemes, anyways. Do you know the difference between an Azure code and a threshold scheme? So they are very similar, but they are different. So the difference is when you can always decode a threshold scheme, while with an Erasure code, the Erasure code will refuse to decode. So this is why we say that a threshold scheme is a cryptographic primitive, while the Erasure code is not. But functionally, they are almost the same. Finally, the latest property of interest is the repair bandwidth. How many fragments do you need to repair a missing fragment? And we'll see some codes have different characteristics. So these are the main types. It's a non-exhaustive list. I don't pretend summing up the whole science, but typically the type of codes which have been applied to storage. The traditional RS codes, typically the one we use today in storage systems, the LDPC codes, some research, so they are heavily used in network application, but some researchers showed that it's possible to use them in storage scenarios. LRC codes, typically for big data, Hadoop, so at the recent FAST conference, it has been presented. And those, and the codes of interest, the FFT-based codes. So I won't go into the details because I don't have time and I got a lot of slides to show, but basically you may know this, but we typically use a finite field to encode our message. So F finite field based upon the prime number Q, and K is the exponent of the prime number. So typically we take 2 as a prime number because it's very convenient. And we define what we call a binary extension field. So it's a power of a prime number, and 2 is so convenient that we use it. And then we define, we encode our message by using a polynomial on top of this finite field. So to encode and to generate codes, we take different random points in the field, and we apply the following equations. To solve, to compute and solve those equations, you can do what we call a matrix multiplication. So this is a typical operation we do. This is known in the field. You can find articles about it. So what can we say about it? So there are simple codes. They support systematic, non-systematic, adaptive rates, and all you have. Can do plenty of optimization around. But the bad is the complexity of computing the code is basically a matrix multiplication, so it's k multiplied by n. So it's okay if you have, 10 plus 5, because you have 50 operations. But if you do a code, if you use a code with hundreds of data and hundreds of parties, then you have 10,000 operations. So, this is a bad. So some researchers tried to optimize this by using hardware acceleration. So it's part of the solution. But when you deal with mathematical complexity, it's not enough. So So the other type of codes are LDPC codes, so low density parity check matrices. So quickly, you take a matrix of, so if you want a C8-4, you generate a matrix 8x4. You generate random 1 and zeros. So they have to obey some conditions. So this is summed up here. So what is interesting is, so you generate a set of equations, here 4 equations, on top of your data and codes. So here, we have 4 data and 4 codes because 4 plus 4 equals 8. And typically, so C0, C1, C2, C3 are your data, and C4, C5, C6, C7 are your codes. And so you to compute the code, you simply take the matrix. Every time you got a 0, you don't connect. Every time you got a 1, you connect. So here, 1, so 0, you don't connect, 1, 1, and so on. So, and you define a system of linear equations, such as, for instance, in this case, C1 plus C3 plus C4 plus C7 equals 0, and so on. You define 4 equations, you solve them, it's a very simple system of linear equations, and you have your code. At any time, you can, if you lose C2, for instance, you can, by applying those equations, if you have, for instance, C4, C5, C6, C7, C0, C3, you can decode back. The main problem of LDPC applied to storage is the following. So here you see you have a, what we call a short cycle. Basically, you have an interdependency between the two equations. So if you lose C2 and C5, you cannot decode. So this is a problem. So in a network typical application, you can ask the sender to resend the missing data. But in a storage application, you can't, because it's lost forever. So they may be good, but they are not good enough for us because of this problem. So summed up here. So the thing is, they are very, very fast, and I will show you some performance comparisons. They are super fast, yes, but they are not MDS. And for us, it's a problem. Also, designing a good LDPC is some kind of black art, so it's known in the field. You may have some commercial libraries which are super interesting with all the properties you want and all, but they are commercial. And our philosophy was to do something open, simple, clear. So we could not use LDPCs for that. Another important class of codes applied to storage were the locally repairable codes. And like a few years ago, 2 or 3 years, some people from Facebook presented typically an application using elephants, where in the context of Hadoop and big data, it makes sense. So typically, you have, let's say you have 2 data centers, and you spread your data on top of 2 data centers. So here you spread on 14 disks. The problem, if you lose one disk on one data center, so beside using the LRCs, if you are just using a read Solomon code, if you lose, let's say, X5, you will have to read at least K fragments. So here it's, I didn't say it, but it's a C1410. So you will have to read at least 10 fragments to be able to decode. And this is a problem, because losing a disk, as they explained in the paper, is very common, very frequent. So to avoid this, you generate local parities. And if you lose, let's say, X5, you can rebuild locally, and you don't have to cross another data center and latency to decode. So this is very interesting, and this works well. But in the type of application we want to do, which is basically archive, optimizing the repair bandwidth is not strictly necessary. It's useful for, let's say, big data, you know, but not for archive. So I summarize what I said. So. Basically, it's a smart way for solving the read Solomon code issues, but the problem is they are not MDS and you have an overhead. So the code of interest are the FFT-based code, and actually they are pure read Solomon codes. They are no different than read Solomon codes. The only difference is that we try to optimize this multiplication. So a multiplication, a matrix multiplication in a field can be expressed as a polynomial multiplication. And we know, thanks to an algorithm called Schoenaerts-Strassen, that we can optimize multiplication of polynomials by using fast Fourier transforms. And so we can apply this. So this is a known theory, and we didn't invent this. We just we have read papers about it, and we decided to apply. So the condition to apply is that you need to divide your so typically you take the cardinal of the set of all your elements of the field, and if you can express it as the product of two numbers, then you can reduce the separation by two, and so on. See, for instance, N1, if you can reduce it by two, if N1 is itself composite, you can also reduce. If you choose carefully N, and if you, especially if you choose an hyper composite number, then you can reduce the complexity to N log N instead of N square, typically. So the problem, the problem is, so generally in storage, we choose binary extension fields, so we should exponent of prime numbers fields. And to be able to apply this FFT, the cardinal of the field, minus one, must be composite. So if you take a power of two and you do minus one, it's not composite. And most of the time, it's a prime number. So it's not ideal. So we need to find prime numbers because we need to find a field, so some kind of prime number or a multiple of prime number, such as the prime number minus one is hypercomposite, like an exponent of two. And those numbers exist, they are called the Fermat numbers. They are defined from like this, so two exponent I plus one, for I less than four. Typically, the two fields of interest for us are F257 and F65537. Those numbers, those fields are super interesting because they are highly composite. I mean, the cardinal minus one of those fields can be expressed as power of two. So if they can be expressed as power of two, we can divide and divide and divide number of operations up to down to logarithmic scale operations, logarithmic complexity. So recently, some other researchers have found a way to apply FFT in binary extension fields. So this is a very interesting research. And of course, we cannot apply the multiplicative FFT technique. But basically, how does it work? We define, I don't pretend inventing this. They define a base, and they redefine the items, the elements of the field as composed of those elements of those bases. And basically, they can define an additive group where you can apply a transform which is similar to an FFT. So both multiplicative additive FFTs are very good, very interesting, have a very set of properties. They are simple. They look complex, but actually they are not. They have an interesting mathematical complexity. They are MDS, and they are very fast for very large n. And when we say large n, we can take, for instance, codes with 65,000 symbols. So I can define a code which is 30,000 plus 30,000, for instance, which is totally crazy, but it's possible. And it will be computed super fast. So the bad is the repair bandwidth, because it's a read Solomon code, so we need to get k fragments to decode. But this is for the application we want to do, we don't care. So what did we do? So we implemented both additive and multiplicative, but we focused on optimizing the multiplicative, because it's a lot of work. And typically, in this FFT, you have an operation called the butterfly, which is some kind of vector manipulation. And you have, most of the time, addition, subtraction, and multiplication. So entry-wise product of vectors. And we decided to vectorize that. So we had two approaches. The first approach was to do an horizontal vectorization, basically where you take your file, you divide, let's say, in 50, and you take the first item, the first byte of the first fragment, the first byte of the second fragment, and so on. You compute a vector, and you apply, and basically we vectorize operations. And we found out that actually the vertical vectorization, where you take the first byte of the first fragment, the second byte of the first fragment, the third byte of the first fragment, and you apply the FFT on itself, is much faster because you have some kind of cache effect. So you, this is the performance we get over the field. So typically for n, so the number of symbols 256 and 8 data fragments, so it's basically 248 codes. We can encode on one core at nearly 1.4 gigabytes a second, so which is good. So if you multi-thread on multiple cores, you can, you know. And with different parameters and different ends, you have different performance. So little variation. Also, in terms of decoding, we are not that good. Because for now, the decoding is a slow Lagrange interpolation. We are trying to optimize. We are talking with researchers to see how we can optimize. But it's okay. I mean, we are in the range of, let's say, 100 megabytes a second. So we can do both systematic and non-systematic. Yeah, so here we measure the non-systematic one. And the systematic is a bit slower for encode. But obviously, if you have nothing to decode, you have nothing to do. The problem, I will show that in a decentralized application, you cannot really apply systematic codes. I will show you by example. So this is the effect of the vectorization. So it's not very interesting, but basically we have a sweet spot in terms of packet size when we vectorize. We can go back on this. So for the speed comparison, we took ISA-L, which is the Intel Storage Acceleration Library, which is an open source library, but which is a Reed Solomon cost based. So it's a basic Reed Solomon, which is hardware accelerated with SIMD. So WireHair, which is an hybrid LDPC, and Leopard, which is an additive FFT based, which is hardware accelerated. So both two libraries are from a friend, Katid. It's a researcher which is working at Facebook. So we work with him, we discuss. He's somehow a competitor because he has his own library. But we try to progress together. So this is the raw performance. So you see ISA, although it's very good for a small number of fragments, but because of the matrix multiplication, after some time, this is the, even if you hardware accelerate, this is the power of the mathematical complexity. We decrease. So WireHair, which is an LDPC, which is very good, but you know it's an MDS code, so it's not very interesting for us. We are there, so oscillating between 1500 and 500 megabytes a second, depending on the number of symbols. So you can imagine the type of application we can have there. Yeah, question? Yeah. So, and you see Leopard is not here yet, because it doesn't work for the rates. Those rates, so the typically the encoding rate is 1/4. So so this is the decoding, so we are not that good, but we try to make progress. So this is another comparison. I will go faster, I will try to show the interesting points. So this is the rate 1/3. Again, Leopard is not here. We are okay in terms of performance. Decode is not that great yet. So here we have rate 1/2, and you see Leopard thrives. We are relatively constant in terms of performance. What else can we say? This is the decode. So this is rate 2/3. So you see in rate, what is interesting to see is that in rate 2/3, the LDPC doesn't behave very well. I don't know exactly why, but so it's quite complex to explain, but anyways. So this is it for the performance comparison. What can we say, seriously? Our code works for all rates, so it's a rate more or less insensitive. Decent performance for encoding, decoding, much less than LDPC. So Leopard, which is an additive FFT, they are way beyond us in terms of optimization. So this is a work in progress. So what do we want to do? Decentralized storage. Just checking the time. So we want to build a system which is distributed on the planet, which is super simple with very minimal synchronization. Simple, so typically compiling on a web assembly, which is a new type of assembly. Fast for more than 24 fragments, ideally 50 or 100. MDS, because for us, a rock solid contract. Rate insensitive, because we may want to define, in some cases, more rates, and some other cases, less, so on. Systematic for small fragments, and non-systematic for larger fragments, because we are interested by the confidentiality aspect. We are sure that if you have k minus one fragments, you cannot decode. It's like a threshold scheme, actually. So why non-systematic? Because we did some kind of statistical experiment, but the more fragments you have, the probability of reaching a fragment which is in clear decreases. So it's not that much interesting to use systematic code, in fact, because the probability to get a plain text fragment, and you also lose the confidentiality, which is a super interesting property. So it doesn't prevent you to encrypt, because you want to be sure that nobody can decode, but it adds some confidentiality overall. So this is an example of applications. Typically, we are going to use a blockchain. It's not just a buzzword, but it's a technology that works. So it depends if you want to build a trusted network or a non-trusted network. If you want to build a non-trusted network, typically you have multiple storage providers on the planet and you don't trust them, you just want to buy their storage, for instance, then you are going to use proof of work and something like Bitcoin and all. If you are in a trusted environment, it's your own data, own storage systems. You have, let's say, 10 data centers on the globe and 5 data servers per data center. Let's say you have 45 drives per server, which is realistic today. So we are talking about more than 2,000 drives on the planet. So you can use what they call a proof of authority. So Parity is a fork of Ethereum. Typically, you deploy Parity nodes on your 10 locations. Every node can mine the blocks, so it can validate the transactions. And as a client, Quadragon, you basically generate a random, you take your data, you generate the codes, it will generate n random locations, and to store the location of fragments, you validate transactions in the blockchain. So with minimal synchronization, you can build a storage system. So you index the ledgers with the block IDs, to speed up the queries. This is something which is done easily. And you can operate your trusted storage network with minimal synchronization while being able to sustain the durability. So here we are going to use a code which is C5035. So we can lose 3 data centers or 15 servers or 15 multiplied by 45 drives, which is huge. And we have an overhead of 1.4. which is nothing. And you can still have local parities on the server to avoid repairing on the network. So we can use a C4540, a code which has an overhead of 1.1, mostly. So the total overhead is 157. So if you have 10 terabytes drives, for instance, you buy cheap drives. You have 22 petabytes of storage and 14 petabytes usable. I let you make the computation, but with an overhead of basically 1.5. And you are able to sustain all those losses. So this is, so you think no management, nothing. You just generate the locations, store, do transactions. You want to recover the data. You have indexes. You index your ledgers. You know exactly where your fragments. You get them back. You know. Make the computation in terms of hardware cost and the cost of cloud storage today. You know, there are some opportunities. So just checking the time. We got 2 minutes. So we want to, why do we do this? So a possible future for Quad Iron is it can fit into our existing product, Zenko. So Zenko is a multi-cloud controller. So as a client, you can talk S3 API to Zenko, cloud server. And we can make multiple copies. So typically, our own storage system, Ring, or Amazon, or all the clones, Wasabi, which are very cheap clouds, GCP, Azure, or the Quad Iron network. And they can be very cheap alternative for cloud storage. Typically, instead of storing one copy on Amazon, which costs 10x, typically, you can store, first with Zenko, you can store on Wasabi, and let's say DigitalOcean, so cost you 2x. But also, you can leverage a very cheap storage infrastructure where the cost is x divided by 10 or something. So you have the choice. So this is the UI of Zenko. If you have questions, I can show you. So using a library, so it's open source, the GitHub, BSD license, we use CMake. This is an example of code, so it's C++, and we try to use the proper mathematical abstraction in C++, so especially all the finite field definition and all. We did everything from scratch, so it's super interesting as a scientific project. You have all the flavors of FFTs and subfields and all we implemented and all. So it was very important for us to have this clean abstraction. And so what are the next steps? So now we are relatively slow in decoding. We need to optimize. So we know that for special values of K and M, we can go much faster. We do have an implementation of additive FFTs, but they are not hardware accelerated. And for instance, Leopard is thriving and is hardware accelerated. So this is a track of research for us. We can go this way and try to also have fast additive FFTs. So we do have systematic multiplicative FFTs, but we don't have systematic additive FFTs yet. So then the research is infinite. We can try to implement adaptive FFT code. And recently some papers were published to boost the computation of the FFT in some specific cases and all. So it's, as a science project, it's super interesting. I mean, it's infinite. So if you want to contribute, those two persons are the main developers. Lam is has a PhD and a postdoc on Erasure codes. And Sylvain is more working on the C++ aspect, templatization. Those two persons are working part-time on the project, and myself. But we are looking for people interested to contribute. So we don't have a patent on the code. So we can't, because the project is already open source. So you cannot patent something which is open. We don't plan to do anything with it. I mean, we give it to the community. For now, we don't have so much traction. But if we have more traction, we will more organize some kind of. We may organize an open source foundation, or whatever, around it. I mean, this is really the idea. And are we going to use it? Maybe. You know, it's here. The goal is we're trying to have fun and do, you know, and learn things and build interesting things. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask me.
Do you have a comparison of the hardware requirement and the number of gates versus what's used now?
For running this?
For the
solar implementations. So we can run from mobile phones to Linux computers and Linux servers. So we have a basic C++ implementation. And if you have SIMD, so typically you're running on Intel compatible hardware, we
so
can access
software. You're not planning a hardware implementation.
We do have a SIMD acceleration, SIMD vectorization already for the multiplicative FFTs. And thanks to this, we can have some encoding performance like 1.5 gigabyte per second per core. If you don't have a CMD, it's more 100 megabyte, something like that. So we are really, you see the ISA-L, I don't know if you know, ISA-L, the Intel software acceleration, the storage acceleration library. So they are optimized for basic read settlements. We are doing exactly the same, but for entity-based. And you can use the library just like you can use ISA-L in your applications and all. It's so Intel claim it's also open source. You can do whatever you want with it. There is no patent, nothing. So same spirit, but we target on more symbols because we think that if you want to build decentralized storage, you need hundreds of fragments, possibly thousands. Because the thing is, the price of storage is going down, the famous down to zero curve. So it will be cheaper and cheaper to store data. And thanks to this, it will be possible to use more fragments to increase the durability. Because the more fragments you have, the more codes, the more durable your system is. So this is the idea. So it's a bit early for this kind of systems, but so we there are some projects already. Maybe you've heard about Filecoin, Storage, Siacoin. Those projects, they want to leverage typically the hard drives, which are unused, and resell. They try to build some kind of ecosystem and some kind of incentive for people to resell their unused drives and so on. So we don't plan exactly to do this. When we talk about blockchain, it's not to do yet another coin or whatever. It's really to use the technology because which is interesting for us is a proof of authority. Because you don't have to mine anything. You trust yourself. So you have 10 data centers. They belong to you. You trust yourself. And you are simply using the Merkle tree of the blockchain to mold the transactions in some ledger, and that's it. Because it requires no synchronization for doing so, but minimal synchronization. When you validate a transaction, so you have a majority of peers, in our case, 6 out of 10 authority validating the transaction, you're sure that everybody will have the information at the end of the day. And since you are going to design your application to be immutable, so your blocks to be either immutable or deleted, you only have two states. Then you just need to read them, and to read them you just read the ledger. So it's super slow to unstack the ledger from the start, but typically we index the ledgers. So by block ID, so it's super fast. It's like you have local DBs optimizing the ledgers and all. And this is it. You don't need a database. You don't need, I mean, you need a temporary database for indexing, but it's not like you need a central database that you can lose. And all. You know, it's, you have 10 copies of the ledgers all over the place. So you don't need anything else. So we think it's a feasible system. Thanks.